Okay. So when we speak about data, I will usually think about something like this. There is a table with rows and columns. Each row, I think that each row contains information of an individual. Maybe this is mine. And this is Salil's. And like maybe other people in the project, this is Or. And but can you guess who that is? Can you? And for each of us, there is a collection of information. For instance, age, I'm 26, and gender, and so on. Like maybe also address, and something that could be also sensitive. For instance, whether somebody is a computer scientist, this is a plus for me. Or a statistician, and so on. This is a minus for me. And social scientist, or maybe a lawyer. And so on. And we can fill this table with the rows. And this is the structure roughly that we'll have in our minds. And many people collect data, scientists, companies, governments collect data, and they have a lot, tons of good uses for this. Research, national security, we heard. But it introduces risk to individuals. I'm not going to things that Salil said. But also there is risk to the users of the information. For instance, if you're doing research, and privacy is breached, that could harm your reputation, that could harm the reputation of your institution, that could cost money to your institution, and so on. Okay, so these are things that we want to avoid, and the main question that we will ask is how to perform interesting analysis of the data. With privacy protection. And I think we all have this like fuzzy understanding what an analysis is, and we'll try to understand what we mean by privacy protection. I'll try to motivate the definition of the threshold of privacy to get there and to understand it today. Now, this is not a new problem, and there are many solutions that have been developed, practical solutions that are actually being used. And you heard about some of these in Michael's talk and in Salil's talk. But what is going to be new is that we're going to focus on a rigorous treatment of privacy. So we want a mathematical definition of privacy. We want to be able to state it accurately. We want to be able to prove consequences of this definition. So not that it feels good or it is. It agrees with our intuition. We want actually to be able to prove that this has a meaning in some sense. We want to be able to design algorithms and prove that they satisfy the privacy protection requirement. And also we want to understand it in a broader sense. We want to understand what are the limitations, what can be computed what can be computed privately, what cannot be computed privately, and so on. And finally, we want to establish connections between that notion that we'll develop of privacy protection and other notions from other research areas. And interestingly, differential privacy does have that. I hope we'll manage to present some of these throughout this summer. Now, when you compute over data, so this is going to be my data now. You usually apply some procedure. That was the curator that Salil mentioned. You will use also the terms mechanism or
algorithm or computation for this thing, and this procedure outputs something. And it's natural to try to define privacy in terms of what this output is. For instance, suppose there was a line in this output saying something like this. Okay? Hi, George. Suppose there's the output is like in tabular form and it contains this line. What do you think? Is that good for my privacy? Is that bad for my privacy? What would you say?
It's bad.
You think it's bad? Somebody thinks it's good for my privacy? So intuitively, this looks like it's bad for my privacy. And indeed, many of the tries to define privacy looked at the outcome and said, if the outcome has a line that somebody can identify as mine, and there's information there, then probably it's bad. But I want to claim that this is not necessary. Suppose this procedure is like that. This is the algorithm. Ignore input and output that Kobbi is a computer scientist. Now, with this algorithm, there's no functional relationship between the input and the output. The output is just fixed. So there's no chance that this output actually leaks anything about the input here. Okay? And actually, the output will be the same whether I'm a computer scientist or a statistician or a lawyer. Okay? And hence, at least in the notion of if we think about privacy as leakage of information, this procedure is not breaching my privacy. Okay? So let's try to continue with such games and to see what kind of lessons we can learn from them. So here we see that something about the relationships between input and output is important to control, not just the output. Okay. So this kills this naive trial. And some other trials at defining privacy, say, let's look again about what happens here as the outcome. And suppose what happens is something like this. We put the data in. And let's say I only care about my own privacy. So what is outputted here is data minus my information. Okay, this technique is called reduction. It's not a way to prove NP-hardness. What do you think? Is my information, is that fine now? Is my privacy protected because my information was redacted from the outcome? What's your intuition? Kimya says yes. Okay? Do you agree with Kimya? Well, if I ask it, the answer must be no, I guess. And again, the question is, why is my information redacted here? For instance, maybe this procedure just redacts everybody that is a computer scientist, okay? So from the mere fact that my information was redacted, you learn something about me. So again, it's very important to look at what this procedure is, the way it interacts with the data, and what we can learn from that interaction when we look at the outcome to decide whether privacy is preserved. Okay? So this is a simple lesson, and here we saw just two very simple examples. In the more general case, it may be that more generally, it may be that the output is not in tabular form. And then it would be harder, just by looking at the outcome, to tell what this says about me. Okay, maybe it's not explicit like in these two examples. But the fact that there's no record, like no line in the output of this form, doesn't say that information about me is not leaked. Again, what's important is this relationship between input and output, and what you can learn about the input, knowing that relationship and the outcome, okay? And then we can have many more, much more complicated dependencies than the two that we've seen here. Okay. So differential privacy is going to be a definition for privacy. So what is the object that differential privacy has to speak about? What kind of object? What do you think? So, I'm going to say something. A something is differentially private
data set?
If. So what should happen here?
A data set?
A data set. Why a data set?
Because a combination of different fields can reveal who the person is.
Okay. But a data set is something like in this first picture. That's a data set. So in a sense, there is a could contain information about an individual. Okay, it will, in a sense, never be private. This is contains information that we are trying to hide.
An entry.
Why an entry?
One row about one individual or one individual observation.
Okay. Other ideas? Data set, entry. Yep.
A procedure.
Why a procedure?
Because the procedure takes the data and like does something with it.
Okay, a procedure. We have three options now. What else? Okay. So, as we've seen in these examples, what's important to control is the way that data is transformed to an output. Okay. And hence, what we want to control is indeed the procedure or the algorithm. And differential privacy is going to be a property of an algorithm. We'll say that an algorithm is differentially private if so and so happens. Okay? So, I'm going to use the term mechanism because it's a fancier word for algorithm. But it shouldn't confuse you. When I say mechanism, I mean an algorithm or computation. And there are going to be parameters here. I'll begin with one parameter, epsilon, that Salim mentioned. But it's important to remember that we're talking about a mechanism. It's not a particular output. It's not the data. It's the transformation between the data and the output that we're trying to control. And it will have this property that we call differential privacy if, for all, okay, actually, I'll leave this for now, and as we proceed with the discussion, I will fill that in with details. I want to mention, beyond the fact that this is talking about a mechanism, there's also some. The parameter here says that we are going to qualify privacy. Like, we could set epsilon to be 1, 0.1, 1 in 1,000, and all these settings will give us different quantifications of privacy. And this is important to have this kind of graded notion of privacy when we try to prove consequences of privacy. So we'll prove consequence of choosing epsilon being 0.1. Okay, what does that mean in terms of what we can tell about risks or things like that? Okay, so it's graded or qualified. It's not that we're saying this is private, period. This is not private, period. This is private with parameter epsilon. Now, one more thing before we get into the definition. Can we expect that everything about me will remain a secret? Okay. So can you give me an example of a mechanism that doesn't reveal any secret about me? Well, yeah.
Ignore input, always output A.
For instance, so this is clearly not revealing anything about me or the data, but it's not very useful, okay? Now, when we use mechanisms that are useful, okay, we're in an essential way, we want to leak information about the data, we want to expose information about the data. So it's not going to be the case that we are completely hiding information about those who participate. This is something important to remember. If you want to completely make sure we don't leak any kind of information, we're not going to get utility from data. Okay? So we have to make a compromise, and I want to claim that we'll make a reasonable compromise, and we'll play with that today in other meetings, and I hope you will be convinced. It's not a compromise that works every time. Salim mentioned some cases where even learning something about the entire population may not be kosher, but in most cases, or in many cases, this is going to be a good compromise. And the example Salim gave, for instance, with smoking, suppose you see me smoking in public. Suppose nobody knows that smoking is related to lung cancer, and then somebody comes, collects data, does the analysis, and we learn that there is a correlation between smoking and lung cancer. Now, you've seen me smoking in public. Now you learn something new about me, that I have a higher risk of having lung cancer. Something was learned about me. It's not that I am totally protected, and differential privacy is not going to give me such a protection. Okay. Another example, suppose a Martian comes, he thinks everybody has four fingers, he looks at data, he learns that an average person has five fingers in each hand, and hopefully in each paw, and this is something that Martian learned about me from the data. This is not something that we are going to try to prevent. So some information is going to be learned about me. The intuition is that if this information is could be learned from the entire population, then that's fine. Okay? This intuition is captured in differential privacy. In a sense, we're saying there are two extremes, maybe. There is this extreme of information that should not be leaked about me. This is information that is particular to me. Okay? There's information that we are allowing to compute or to leak on the data, and this is information that is holistic. It pertains to the entire population. Okay? And differential privacy is going to be a concrete way to instantiate this definition of what is allowed, like the holistic data, and what is disallowed to be learned, which is a particular information of an individual. Okay. So before I write the definition, let's try to capture what it means that information is specific to me. Okay? And here's what I'll try to do. Suppose we take the data, okay, and we put it into some computation, into a mechanism, and we get some outcome. This is what is going to happen in the real world. Okay? We take data, put it into computation, we get an answer. But we also have some imaginary world. I'll call it the ideal world. This is going to be ideal for me because in this data now, this is the row with my information, and I'm going to change it arbitrarily. We'll feed that into our computation and get another outcome prime. Okay? And to capture the idea that nothing in the outcome is particular to me, we would require that these two are in a sense the same. So that's the basic idea of how to define a computation that does not leak information that is particular to me. Okay. That is going to be, I would take that as a good enough protection if that happens. Intuitively, this says that if somebody can learn something from this outcome, because this outcome is essentially the same, he could also learn that information from this outcome. Particularly if something about me could be learned here, but I have five fingers, this also could be learned about me from here. But here we're not feeding anything particular to me into the mechanism. So information that is particular to me is never leaked here. And hence, because these are very similar, it also is never leaked. This notion of equality is going to be also parameterized with the same parameters that we'll have for the privacy definition. Now, in this picture, I protected myself, so that wasn't maybe very social. I just made sure that my information is not, nothing about me is leaked. Nothing that is particular to me is leaked by the computation. But I also care about Thomas. And for Thomas, we'll draw another kind of ideal world, which is the same, except that not my record is changed, but Thomas's change is. And Thomas's record is changed. And similarly for Caper and for Daniel and for everybody of you. So
in a sense, we are going to have one real world and many of these ideal worlds that we would like to be able to prove this kind of similarity. Okay. For all these instances, we would like to claim this kind of similarity. When that happens, we would say that for each of the individuals whose data is in the data set, we guarantee privacy. For each of these individuals, we are not leaking information that is particular to him or her. Did I miss anything? Okay. So, just a small technical definition, and then we get to state differential privacy. We're going to use the term neighboring data sets. So two data sets, X and X prime, say they are taken from some domain X, and each of them has N records or N rows, okay? So two data sets like that are called neighboring if they differ on just one entry. Let's write it this way. Okay. So they differ . So using this language of neighboring data sets, what we want is to protect neighboring data sets, all possible neighboring data sets. And this is what will require differential privacy. Okay, so before I get to write the actual definition, questions? I will not write the definition now in its most general form. We'll do that later, not today. I will just write it in a way that is slightly easier to work with for the purposes of today's meeting, but we'll get to the more general definition. So we say that the mechanism is epsilon differentially private if, for all neighboring X and X prime, now I want to say something like what we had in the picture. We want to say that if we apply M on X, we get something similar to what would have happened if we applied M on X prime. And the way you write it is we require that for all possible outputs, let's call an output Y, the probability of getting the output Y when M is applied to X is similar, I didn't leave enough space here, is similar to the probability of obtaining Y when we apply M on the neighboring database. And we allow some difference between the two. This is where the parameter epsilon comes in. So there is a constant difference between them. And that's the basic definition of
differential function. So a few notes. Don't be confused by this inequality being like in just one direction, because we have this for all requirement here, and the neighboring relationship is symmetric. We can also exchange x and x prime, so it's symmetric. Okay. The other thing is, if epsilon is small, then what would you say is e to the epsilon? If epsilon is small, e to the epsilon is roughly
one.
Roughly one, or slightly more accurately,
one plus epsilon.
One plus epsilon. Certainly, if epsilon is zero, then e to the epsilon is one. There's going to be a third bullet, but I want first to look at this. What happens if epsilon is zero, by the way? What can you say about
the probability of getting output y for the first data set is the same as getting it for the second data set?
It's exactly the same, good. And this is for all possible y's. So if you look at the outcome of M as like the distribution on outcomes, then it's exactly the same distribution, okay? Required for all neighboring data sets. So what would you say happens? How does M look like? Can you give me an example for such a mechanism when epsilon is zero?
It just outputs the true response.
Sorry?
Just outputs the true data.
Outputs the true data. Let's see. Another idea?
Always outputs the same thing.
Always outputs the same thing. For instance, that mechanism that says Kobbi is a computer scientist will be like that. It ignores the data and always outputs the same thing. Why? How do you see that?
I mean, the responses would always be the same.
Exactly. The output distribution is always the same distribution regardless of what x is. Okay. So when epsilon is zero, we get perfect privacy. Not a lot of utility. But at least it corresponds to our intuition. If epsilon is small, we should get good privacy. If epsilon is zero, we're getting perfect privacy. Of course, we don't want to set epsilon to zero, then we're not getting any utility, unless we're interested in constant functions or something that doesn't give us any information about the input. But hopefully we could work with epsilon that is non-zero, but still small, like maybe 1 in 10 or 1 in 100. That would give us, it seems, a reasonable notion of privacy. Okay. We're close to that point where we're getting perfect privacy. So when epsilon is zero, we're getting perfect privacy. Which is a very noble desiderata, but it's totally useless. And another thing I want to say, that there is this quantifier here. A couple of things I want to say here is, one, note that there is no probability over the input. We're not making any assumptions on some uncertainty in the input. Actually, if we think about this as a game with a contester, with an adversary, then this quantifier, the for all quantifier, means that our adversary actually is choosing maybe the worst pair of neighboring data sets for our algorithm. And this is where we actually test our algorithm. Okay, so it's a worst case notion of privacy. We're not making any assumption on the inputs. Now you can think about this worst caseness in two ways. One is, it's great to have a worst case guarantee. Then you don't have to worry. How did I obtain that data? If I assume some uncertainty in the data set, is it really there? Maybe there's some uncertainty with respect to me, but Orr already has taken that uncertainty out and he's my adversary. We don't have to worry about anything. But on the other hand, maybe there may be cases where we'll pay a lot for this worst caseness, and maybe there could be other reasonable notions of privacy that are not worst case. We're not going to get into that, but this is a very interesting question. Okay, so for today, I did plan a lot more, which is good because we began late. In the next meeting, so what we'll do next, I will show you a first example on how to construct a mechanism that satisfies epsilon differential privacy. Okay. If we'll have time, we'll see two examples. But this is not going to be the end point. In our next meeting, we're going to speak a little more about the definition and modify it a little. To make it a little more general, so this one is good for the case where the outcome space is discrete, but we will want sometimes to work with continuous output spaces, where this would mean in many cases nothing, because the probability of obtaining a specific outcome is going to be zero. Okay, so we'll want to extend that. And we will want also to relax the definition a little. It turns out that that is helpful. It will remain a worst case definition, but with some kind of relaxation. And we will prove many useful properties of this definition. Let me just gloss over some of them. One, a very natural one, is what we call output. Is what we call post-processing. Post-processing means that you take the outcome, the output of a differentially private mechanism. Now, you don't look at the data anymore, but you continue processing it. Say you got a number there, it was 5.7, and your processing is look at the number and output yes if it's larger than 7, and no otherwise. So in that case, 5.7 will output a no. Okay, so we are processing the outcome without touching the data. Intuitively, you want to say that privacy is still preserved. Okay, if privacy is not preserved, then that would mean we probably have some problem with the definition. Okay, we haven't touched the data, we're just using things that we already outputted. And we'll show that differential privacy has this nice property. If you apply post-processing, privacy is maintained. Another property is, suppose everybody in the world is doing good and everybody works with differential privacy. So there's one implementation here at Harvard and one in Ben Gurion University, my home university, and they produce outcomes independently. Okay. Is it the case that when you have these two instances of differential private computation, differential privacy is still preserved? This is what we call composition. So Lil mentioned this also in his talk today. And we want to prove that privacy is still preserved even if you have more than one instance of differentially private computation, or if you combine differentially private computations into more sophisticated computations. This is important. Also, it should make sense. We don't want something that, if there's more than one instance of that privacy, of a privacy preserving computation, then privacy is broken.
And so this is like a sanity check for the definition. And the other thing is that we want to be able to produce, to design algorithms in a modular way. And this kind of composition will allow us to do that. You will see that we use that a lot. Okay, there are going to be other properties, but these are the two really most important ones and that I will touch upon at the beginning of the next meeting on Friday. So let me now conclude with an example of a differentially private computation that will, at the beginning, look totally useless, but we'll try to make sense out of it. And this technique is called randomized response. So actually, randomized response was presented years before the notion of differential privacy existed. In retrospect, you can say this falls into the framework of differential privacy, and we can analyze it in this framework. It was presented by Warner. When was that? 65 or 75? 1965. Warner is a statistician, and his idea was this: like when you go, when you ask, like in a survey, the surveyor goes and asks an embarrassing question, like, "Are you a computer scientist?" Now, he would give the respondent a dial that has this thing, so it's 3/4 green and 1/4 red, and there is a dial here. Okay. Okay, and then before you answer, you toss the dial. If it lands on this area, then you flip your answer. So if I want to answer when it says this, I say, no, I'm not a computer scientist. If it falls into the 3/4 area, I answer truthfully. Okay? And that was an idea of how to help respondents respond truthfully in this sense, after randomization, to embarrassing questions. Okay? So let me define it accurately. So suppose we have a database of size 1. Okay. So already this doesn't feel that useful. So this is the database. It only has my bit, which is either 0 or 1, corresponding maybe to whether I'm a computer scientist or not. And now we'll define an algorithm. So given a bit X, this algorithm is going to do the following. First, it will toss a coin. By the way, if you're an algorithm, it's very useful to have coins. So keep them with you. It will toss a coin.
Useful to have coins.
What's that?
It's in general quite useful to have coins.
Especially if you're an algorithm. I would say it's more useful to have notes if you're not an algorithm. Where was it? Okay, you flip a coin, and that gives a 0 with probability epsilon over 2 and 1 otherwise. Okay. Now if this coin turned to give a 0, then we respond truthfully, so we just output X, that bit, and otherwise Otherwise, we toss another coin. This is going to be a fair coin. And let's call it B hat. And this is going to be our answer. So this is not exactly the way I drew it with the dial, but you can translate it to that model. So I want to claim that this procedure that works on a database of size one, only one record, and even that record is just one bit, okay? I want to claim that it is differentially private with parameter epsilon. And then I would like also to claim that it's useful. So for instance, so in this case, what would be neighboring data sets, by the way? Remember neighboring data sets? Only differ on my input, yeah?
On the possibility of 0 and 1.
Yeah, exactly. So one data set is the data set containing a single bit 0, and the second one is the data set containing a single bit 1. Okay. So let's look at this. So let's look just, the cases are symmetric. I'll only analyze one of them. So let's look at the case x is 0. So the neighboring data set is 1. And I wish I had. Maybe I'll move. No, that won't be cruel. What we need to show is that the probability for each outcome, the probability of getting that outcome on X and on the neighboring data set X prime is almost the same, and that the difference is by a factor of e to the epsilon, of course. Okay? So this is what we show. For instance, we could ask, what is the probability that if we apply randomized response on X, we get a 0? Okay? And then we'd like to compare that to the probability that if we apply randomized response on 1, we get the 0. And we want to say that the ratio between the two is bounded by e to the epsilon. Okay, so let's do this. What's the probability of getting a 0 when we apply this on 0? So with probability epsilon over 2, we just output the 0. And then with the rest, 1 minus epsilon over 2 probability, we toss a random coin, so half of that time we output a 0. Okay. So we get epsilon over 2 plus 1 minus epsilon over 2 divided by 2. Okay? This is 2 plus epsilon over 4. The probability of getting a 0 when the input is 1. So with probability epsilon over 2, we are outputting the input, which is 1 in this case. So this is not a 0. We're losing that. But with when we toss the random coin, there's a chance of 1/2 that will output a 0. So this is simply 1 minus epsilon over 2 over 2, which is 2 minus epsilon over 4. Now if we take the ratio between them, it's 2 plus epsilon over 2 minus epsilon, which is, for small epsilon, this is about e to the epsilon. if you want to get exactly e to the epsilon, then you can modify this. I hope I didn't make a mistake. It could be e to the epsilon minus 1 over e to the epsilon plus 1. Okay, so you can complete this to also check the case where this is 1, and also replace x and x prime. It's the same computation, so I'm not going to repeat it, but this shows that randomized response is epsilon differentially private. So we just constructed our first differentially private mechanism. And now I want to claim that it is useful. Or questions on this? Okay. So at first sight, this looks total nonsense. Like differential privacy requires that for these neighboring data sets that only contain my information, the outcome of the mechanism should be almost identical. So should no information intuitively should like be conveyed there in the outcome. And indeed, if you just look at the output of this on a single bit, that will be the case. So much noise. The outcome is going to be very similar to like a toss of a random coin. Okay? With small information, with small probability, we are outputting something useful. Otherwise, what we output is totally independent of the input. Okay? But what happens if we now do randomized response over bits of everybody in this room? Maybe we can get more from that. So suppose now, can I erase this?
Yeah.
No objection.
Okay. So suppose now x contains n bits, and we're doing randomized response on each of the bits separately. I missed a few word letters here. Convince yourself that this is epsilon differentially private. Okay, so now we're not doing this on a single bit, but we're doing it on a sequence of bits. I want to claim that this is still differentially private. So what we're getting, we begin with the bits xi, and we're getting the bits yi, which is randomized response of xi. Okay? And suppose what we want to estimate is sum of xi. Let's see what happens, how, if we can do it based on this noisy bits. Okay. So what is, if you look at the expected value of y, what is it? So with probability epsilon over 2, we output xi, and otherwise we just toss a random coin. So this is epsilon over 2 times xi, sorry. This is epsilon over 2 times xi plus minus 1 minus epsilon over 2. Yeah. Okay, so y is 0, 1 variable,
and this is its expectation. If we sum up the yi's, we get something that in expectation then looks like epsilon over 2 times the sum over xi. Here I'm using linearity of expectation plus n times 1 minus epsilon over 2 over 2. So we can compute and estimate z by subtracting this offset and correcting here for the factor. So if we take sigma of yi minus n and what should I put there? Okay. So let's say this is what we output. Okay. Now, without you have even noticing, I used one property of differential privacy that I discussed what we didn't prove. What was that? So, if you did your homework, then the outputs, the yi's, this sequence, outputting that, that's fine, that's kosher, it that preserves differential privacy. What did I do beyond that? I'm not releasing this now, the y. I'm releasing something that depends on y. This is post-processing.
Okay.
What I did here, this is post-processing. Okay. We'll get used to do it without noticing that we're doing post-processing all the time, because the first time I want to make that clear, we're transforming this vector of bits that we got here, generating something new from it, and because we will prove that differential privacy is preserved under post-processing, this is fine. What we get is still preserving differential privacy. Okay. So we get that in expectation, okay, because of all this manipulation we did in expectation, this estimate is exactly what we are looking for. Okay, so there is a chance that this is useful. Okay? Are you convinced that this is useful? If I'm asking, the answer must be no, I guess, but why? Is expectation enough? For an estimate to be useful, or what would you like beyond expectation? Okay, let me ask something else. Am I actually getting the correct sigma xi here? What do you think? Is the outcome going to be exactly sigma of xi? Don't be shy to. Because if it is, then we're done. This is what we wanted, and what do you think? Is there a chance it will not be sigma xi? Why?
Because of the randomized response.
So. Because of the great. So we are adding noise in the process here. We don't expect to get the exact answer. Okay. In the expectation, this is the correct answer, but it's not that we will get that every time we run
the mechanism. Okay? So to claim that we're getting something good, we want to claim that what we're getting is approximately the exact answer, and just showing that the expected answer is correct is maybe a good first step, but it's not enough. We want to claim that we're concentrated around the correct answer, okay? So one measure for concentration could be the variance
I'll do that and then we'll stop.
So, to compute the variance of Z, I'm going to first compute the variance of this sum, and in order to do that, I will begin with the variance of Yi. Yi is a 0, 1 random variable. Okay, so for a 0, 1 random variable, the probability of getting 0 is p, and 1 minus p probability of getting 1, then the variance is p times 1 minus p. Okay? And so the variance of y of each of the yi's is what is the probability of getting zero? We have that on the board. So the probability of getting one of the values is 2 minus epsilon over 4, and getting the other value is 2 plus epsilon over 4. We have that on the board, so the variance is just a multiplication of these two, so we get 4 minus epsilon squared over 4. And then the variance of the sum, when we have a sum of independent variables, then the variance also adds up. So the variance of the sum is just the same thing times n. And the variance of z, so z, we're just doing a shift in the y's. That doesn't change the variance, but then we scale by epsilon over 2. So it's the same variance scaled by 4 over epsilon squared. So we get 8. And here we're not going to, in many cases, to care about the constants. I will just write it something like n over epsilon squared. Okay, what is the constant? Actually, it's 1. Okay, so we expect to see the standard deviation is roughly root n over epsilon. So I would say we expect to see z to be around the expected value, which is what we're looking for. And the error that we introduce is of magnitude about root n over epsilon. If you think about the relative error here, remember that we had n bits, so the relative error is 1 over root n, roughly, which goes down to 0 with n. So if we have enough data, we get a good approximation of the sum. Okay? So I'm going to stop here. Any questions?
Can I make a comment?
Sure.
One thing that is very puzzling about this definition, the first time you see it, there is no adversary in the definition. Think of all the talks that you had yesterday and this morning about how Lahani Sweeney took anonymized data set and found the description of people. All these attacks on so-called other privacy techniques, right? There were attackers, and all of a sudden here we're given a definition of privacy that doesn't even exist an adversary or an attacker in this definition, okay? What Kobbi mentioned about post-processing is exactly the adversary. Think of what they did, right? They took an anonymized data set, something that someone claimed to be private, just look at what they outputted, ran some computation, lo and behold, they found the definition, they found the details of a single person, right? This is post-processing. And when Kobbi says, look, when I do differential privacy, any post-processing you will ever do, no matter what auxiliary information you'll have, you will, if the output will still remain differentially private, it means that whatever an adversary will try to do, the output will remain differentially private.
Okay, thanks for the comment. And you will hear from us many stories like that when we will get back to the definition and try to give different aspects of how we understand it. This is certainly one of them. I want to stop here. Again, questions? Not you or? Yeah?
Since epsilon's small, isn't that a pretty big variance? Or?
It could be, certainly. So that would certainly... Suddenly you want something like this, that n is much larger than root n over epsilon in order to get a good answer from this. Okay, so you see that epsilon matters a lot in the size of the data set that you need to look at. That's a very good point. This is one of the big challenges of differential privacy. We'll see that there are better techniques than getting this. Our next technique is going to give us something like 1 over epsilon instead of root n over epsilon. But this is one of the big challenges of differential privacy. How can we design algorithms that squeeze as much utility as we can from the data, given that we have to adhere to this very strong requirement on the algorithm? This is a point that we'll make again and again and again. Other questions? So please go over this, because on Friday I'll begin from this point. If there are any questions about the probability computations that we are doing here, or anything that is not clear, do come to me or to Orr or Salil or other people who, Thomas, especially Thomas, and ask, we're here to help. Okay, we'll stop here. Thanks.
Okay, Kelly, anybody stick around for our tutorial?